A very good evening, ladies and gentlemen, and welcome to this third edition of the Together for Education webinar brought to you by Notebook. We hope all of you and your loved ones are keeping safe and staying at home. This is the third in a weekly series of webinars for educators, school owners, administrators, and teachers that Notebook is arranging. We thank you for the overwhelming support and response that we have received for all our previous webinars, and we know that we can count on your support in the weeks to come. Every week at this same time, we will bring to you eminent panelists discussing problems that you face in your roles as educators. I'm your host for today, Shubhayu Roy. I am also the co-founder of Notebook. Today's topic of discussion is keeping students motivated during the lockdown. We have an exciting session planned for you today. So without much ado, let us proceed. Before we move on to our first speaker, let me give you a brief background of the context that we are speaking in. We all are associated with various schools, which today, thanks to the coronavirus pandemic, has shut down. This pandemic is facing humanity today at an unprecedented scale and has left us with a set of problems that we did not even think of until maybe a month ago. Schools in particular are one of the worst affected. However, little has been done to offset the loss of time for teachers, and completing the syllabus is going to be a huge challenge this academic year. In such a situation, digital and online learning tools have assumed greater prominence. The reality, however, is that most of these solutions are expensive, difficult to adapt to, and often require a great deal of technological expertise to navigate. It is also a massive challenge to keep students motivated while they are studying alone at homes and not around their friends in class. We have a stellar line of panelists today. To start with, it is my pleasure and privilege to introduce to you Mr. Philip Burritt. Mr. Burritt retired as the deputy headmaster from the Doon School, Dehradun, after 44 years of serving in education across various institutions. He served the Doon School as housemaster, head of department, dean of student welfare, dean of activities, deputy headmaster, second master, and acting headmaster over many, many years with great distinction. He also carried out a visioning exercise for the Doon School in 2011 through an in-depth study of a number of British public schools and various schools in the US. Mr. Burritt qualified as a leadership trainer at Wellington College, UK in the year 2000. He is also an athlete, an adventurer, and a naturalist. Over to you, Mr. Burritt.
Thank you very much, Shubhayu. I hope you can hear me.
Yep, loud and clear. Yeah.
A very good evening to all our panelists and also to all the people who have tuned into this webinar. As Shubhayu just said, that we are all excited about this online education, and so many of our kids are locked in being taught from home. But while online education brings with it the exciting new technology and tools to this novel approach, this initial motivation and excitement, I think, will be surely followed by a drop in motivation levels. It is not easy for children to shift from a classroom setting, which they have got used to, and start working from a kitchen or a bedroom table where other members of the family are around. I can vision a lot of disturbance and distractions. No wonder research has shown that there's a high student dropout rate from online learning platforms. Teacher motivation can flag also with time. The teacher up till this time was used to a classroom where he or she could pace himself over a school day consisting of 5 to 6 periods. And this was done by mixing the type of lessons he or she was teaching. Let's say 2 heavy lectures may be followed by an assignment lesson or a research-based lesson where the teacher can ease off a bit. This could be followed by a lesson of self-study or a flipped classroom method. But in online education, the teacher is on high RPM all the time. There is little or no easing of the pressure, and there's no downtime for the teacher. Unless, of course, he has planned a variety of lessons. And also, we mustn't forget that teachers online are being monitored by parents and school heads. And controlling a class of over 30 on a Zoom screen is not easy. It all adds to the stress. Therefore, the name of the game over the next few weeks will have to be, how do we build motivation? I look at it from the point of view of the word motive, which is the reason why we do things. Motivation is an engine of learning. It can influence what we learn, how we learn, when we learn, to choose what we learn. Motivated learners take on more challenges. They do better academically, are more actively engaged. They enjoy their learning, adopt a deep approach to learning, and are far more creative. I believe that if children are told why they are doing things, they will work out the how to do them. And of course, different things motivate different students differently. We're all different. Therefore, in a classroom setting, a teacher will do well to get to know his students individually and to connect with them, which is a little of a disadvantage in online learning. If I look back to my days in a boarding school, and I want to make a small list of things that helped motivation, this would be my list. The first is, how do I help students develop a love for their activity and subject? How do I create an interest around the subject? And how do I de-link the learning of a subject from just exams and marks? I think the best is to create opportunities that link the subject with a hobby or a spare time activity or a service by broad basing the scope of the subjects. For example, a physics teacher might also get involved with the physics club. The children might attend symposiums, science quizzes, going on exhibitions, fairs. They enter writing competitions. They make models. They start a physics society. They invite scientists. They might start a science magazine. They might sit together and do some MOOCs. I knew a biology teacher who created such interest around this subject through nature walks, insect counts, going down to the river. Kids were always in his house, poring over his encyclopedias, his pictures, collecting feathers of birds, looking for nests, visiting national parks, linking up with other schools' nature clubs, making boards on wildlife on the campus, starting a bio newsletter. So when someone goes for a college interview, for example, and asks a student what he's interested in and prove that he's interested in a subject, what would the student do apart from saying, I got 95 marks in the subject? He will show interest in the activities that he has done around the subject. For example, an English student would involve himself in speeches, Trinity College speech and drama, world debates, going to book fairs, lit festivals, interaction with authors, etc. The very idea of studying a book for the purpose of passing an exam is demotivating. One should see the movie, take the historical perspective, read about the author, check the arts, architecture, the dress and customs of the period. The second thing would be the role modeling of a teacher. The teacher's very own interests, his energy, his drive, the attitudes, his life examples goes a long way in motivating students. A teacher who enters the class excited, rubbing his palms together in excitement, having taken his class out for a museum visit the previous week, will have students eating out of his hand. Especially if the teacher, especially in a residential school, has hobbies. Maybe he's a photographer. Maybe he flies his drone. Maybe he makes boomerangs. So role modeling of excitement is very important. The third would be the opening of any lesson, the hook. The importance is, how do you introduce a lesson? If you haven't got children focused on you in the first 3 minutes, you probably have lost them. How do you link that opening introduction to what you're going to teach over the next 45 minutes? And it's important also to link and correlate subjects that you're teaching. For example, a student might be very keen on physics, but not in geography. But if you link, let's say, the teaching of climate to physics, because understanding humidities would mean understanding gas laws, adiabatic cooling, then you get that student hooked on. So very important how a teacher starts the lesson. The other thing is, of course, that nothing succeeds like success. students must be allowed to feel success, to do well in some exams. If a cricket team, for example, loses every match it plays, there'll be a flagging of motivation. He has to see that he is improving, that he is growing, that he is progressing. The other point would be encouragement and feedback, which is again a weakness of the online system. A teacher's encouraging words and feedback are important to children. They inspire children, especially if the child knows that he is going to be the secretary of the geography club or the math society, and he is growing into something. He's inspired. Children need to be praised when they have done well. They also have to be helped when they haven't done well. The next thing, of course, would be knowing your students, showing that you understand that each one has an individual learning style. You know their weaknesses, their strengths. You know how they learn. This would go a long way in motivating a child, because he knows that you like him. He knows that you have taken a special interest to get to understand him. And again, I would say, trying to relate what a teacher is teaching to real life, you know, by visiting shops, hotels, speaking to people, joining, economic forums, visiting a bank, stock market. If you're a history teacher, and then, you know, you might visit the parliament. If you're a maths teacher, you could talk about the Duckworth-Lewis system of cricket scoring. Linking your subject to life. Coming down to online teaching. What is the problem with online teaching, and why does online learning sometimes lack motivation? One, of course, is that there's a lack of structure and clarity on the path forward. Secondly, there's this feeling of isolation because you're not connected to the teacher. The third would be not enough one-to-one feedback on assigned work. And of course, there's the usual delays and challenges and connectivity and using the internet, the interface. And the best ways, I would think, of overcoming these would be to provide opportunities for students to personally connect with their subject matter. Having students set their own goals, setting up a system of self-monitoring and progress tracking, encouraging students to collaborate with the teacher on reading materials or the syllabus, and for the teacher to act more as a facilitator rather than the transmitter of information. Now, setting clear and measurable goals are the best source of motivation for online education. Setting goals regularly so that students have a focus rather than setting open-ended questions and leaving it for them. Goals are important because a student must know exactly what he needs to be done in order for this learning to go forward. You can start by setting whole class goals and that explain the basic expectations of the class. And this can later shift to individual goals. A teacher should specify clearly the time limit, a measurable and quantitative outcome. He should have some means of accountability. For example, when a teacher says, you need to share your knowledge on this platform next time, that's an accountability issue. There has to be a date or a time when these assignments have to be returned. And it's important to get parents on your side in online education because they're hovering around and they can be a great asset. Assessing the posted work and returning it in time with a summary of understanding can go a great way. The other thing, of course, is motivating with rewards and praise. As teachers, we know that praise and rewards work better than punishment. They are much better motivators than punishment. So if we celebrate a student who is engaged responsibly online with his fellow peers, for example, we can create an online gold star chart or positive feedback messages that use fun videos. Or letting your virtual class out a bit early if they've done good work, you know. You could use MS Paint to create simple badges of different students' achievements. Or one could email parents with students' congratulations. I think that it's important that we avoid rewarding students' achievement exclusively, as this motivates only the top performers in the class. Instead, I would suggest to give regular rewards to distant learners who communicate maturely and respectfully online, who set new personal goals, who put in the effort to complete additional activities, and those students who show significant signs of improvement. Rewards and praises don't just motivate distance learners. They allow them to feel connected as well. A single positive comment lets the student know that their teacher is still interested in their learning, no matter how far they may happen to be. Also, I feel that motivation with meaningful feedback is important. Any classroom teacher will know that the motivating power of a timely and thoughtful feedback. The good news is that it's even easier to deliver quality feedback online. We have to take advantage of the fact that we have more time to compose thoughtful and detailed feedback in writing. Also, the ability to communicate privately with individual students. Also, images and videos to support your comments and explanations. I would think that teachers should use these advantages to get creative in the way we deliver feedback. We could personalize it with a voice recording addressed to an individual student. Now, if we are using text to deliver feedback, we must make sure that we keep the tone warm and personable. Use the student's first name and use statements to show that you are thoughtfully engaging with their work. Also, motivation depends a lot on how the lesson, I said, was planned. So a teacher has to work on that introduction. How does he start the lesson? Is it exciting to start with? Does he hook the kids on early? And the last one would be that motivation by personal contact with teachers. Often the best way to motivate students is that if you allow them to connect with the teacher through email or by a phone call. So this gives the students the ability to reach out to the teacher if he has a specific problem and he feels the teacher has not sort of forgotten him. Having said this, Shubhayu, I think I have taken you through some of the ideas of how to motivate students in general and how we can motivate students through online learning. Thank you very much.
Thank you so much, sir, for those enlightening words. I'm sure all the teachers who are in attendance today have been taking notes of the advice that you dealt out. One small request, if I may. People who are raising their hands, we know you have questions and we would like to take them at the end during our question and answer session. There is a Q&A option at the bottom of your screen. There's a small button that says Q&A. If you could please click that and type in your questions, we would try to take them one by one at the end of this session. With that, let me move on to our next speaker. Our next speaker is Mr. Achin Bhattacharya. Achin is the founder and CEO of Notebook. He is a chartered accountant by training, and he was a director at Deloitte prior to starting Notebook. He has worked in India and abroad in various senior capacities in GE, PwC, KPMG, and Deloitte. Achin is an avid reader and passionate traveler. He has a keen interest in economics, history, literature and philosophy. He is a regular speaker at various forums and chambers of commerce and also contributes articles to numerous publications regularly. He is also on the board of some of the most renowned corporates and contributes significantly to brand strategies. Achin, over to you.
Thank you, Shubhayu. Good evening, everybody. It's a pleasure to meet you all in a weekly series of Notebook webinars. Now we are trying to connect with various stakeholders of education from different parts of the country who are selflessly contributing their best to ensure that learning is not interrupted in any way, even during this crisis when schools are closed and children are at home. Today, we are here to discuss about something which is very close to my heart. Motivation to me is divine intervention, which nurtures a soul and gives the courage and strength to relentlessly pursue excellence. Now, we all know that every great story had a beginning. And thus, this brings us to a very important word without which the world would be much poorer than that is, hope. It is very important to encourage a beginner, as you never know that you may be mentoring the next star under your wings. Thus, inspiration is very important, as without that, even the best of domain knowledge won't be of any use. So it is very important that we continuously inspire and motivate. The role of a teacher in today's world is not that of a mere subject matter expert or provider of information. See, there's too much of information around us, but more importantly, he is a mentor who can ignite curiosity and give shape to a ball of clay whom the entire world will be forced to stop and take note of. So in today's age, information is not the bottleneck, and I guess that is the least of our worries. So what is most important is curation of that information. What is most important is helping a student navigate this information overflow. So we are very fortunate. I firmly believe that we are very fortunate that we live in a country which has some of the best teachers in the world. My role takes me to various parts of the globe, and I interact with some of the best minds in education across university campuses, schools, and institutions. I can say with great conviction that as a country, we are blessed to have selfless and creative teachers like you. And I thank you all for shaping up the destiny of our nation in the days to come. Now, the power of education, to my mind, is beyond any doubt or debate. All social challenges that we live with, if there is one single solution to them, that lies in education. However, what is most important is the role of creativity. So we discussed about content, we discussed about the fact that education is important, and I guess that doesn't need any clarification, that needs any explanation. But what is most important is the pedagogy aspect. Now, coming to that, the role of creativity in pedagogy so as to be handhold a child and inspire him to ascend the ladder of success. Now, this is very important. It is only through motivation that we can transform someone from I won't do it to how do I do it, and eventually to yes, I did it. Now, this journey may be uphill many a times, be very demanding, but as masters of the craft, our great teachers know how to accomplish the feat. Now, today, if you see, education has been one of the least transformed sectors. So if you look at things around us, and if you look at the kind of change that we have witnessed, even during past 2-3 decades, I'll say education, to my mind, has been one of the least transformed sectors. For centuries, we have always, the way education has continued, it has always been one shoe fits all approach and chalk and talk method. But I guess time has come when we need to look beyond it. Thus, it is very important to encourage our children to think independently and innovatively. Now, coming to the next part of it. So, you know, this is where I guess technology can play a very big role. To my mind, the basics of education will never change. So whether it is school, a great teacher like you, or an edtech brand like us, the basics of education will always be same. It involves painstaking research. It involves building the content bottoms up. So there's no magic involved, right? And I guess the role of an edtech brand or the role of technology is to act as an enabler, which can act as a bridge between best-in-class teachers and knowledge-hungry students in every corner of the country. So the objective is that no barrier in terms of accessibility or affordability should stand in the way of a young mind eager for knowledge. Now, I firmly believe that time has come for education to reinvent itself, to cater to the needs of the hour. And the role of technology as a catalyst by facilitating engaging learning, peer-to-peer connect, cannot be ignored. Now, you know, as once rightfully mentioned by the legendary American TV personality, Fred Rogers, of Mr. Rogers' Neighborhood Play. Now see, he very rightly mentioned that play is serious learning. And I firmly believe that this proves that if we let our children be themselves, if we trust them, and if we just let them be themselves, we may indeed be up for pleasant surprises. So it is very important, I guess, that we need to nurture the minds of our children, because I guess that is our greatest resource. And we need to nurture them with love, compassion, and inspiration. So now, I guess in today's age, role of a student has undergone a sea change. As I was telling you, that there's too much of information overflow around us. Today, if a child wants to study and wants to watch a video or go through a particular topic, a simple Google search will give access to at least hundreds of information. So the challenge is not information. The challenge is not access to information. So I guess in today's age, students are co-creators of knowledge. And hence, we need to respect their individual learning curves and encourage everyone to learn with joy at their own individual pace without any peer pressure and intellectual shaming. Now, this is very important. I firmly believe that every student has the right to learn at his or her own individual pace. As adults, now if we go to a meeting, we very often see that each one of us have a different way of grasping a particular concept, asking questions. Now, some of us may be go-getters, whereas some of us may take time in grasping a concept. Now, I have come across great people, you know, who are very, very successful in their own individual domain, but I have seen them taking their own sweet time to ask basic questions, to go through a particular concept. But once they're through it, I have seen them being rock solid in what they do. Likewise, we also need to recognize the fact that children as individual, each one of them have their individual learning curve. So at times, it is very frustrating for a child if at every given opportunity, he or she comes under peer pressure with one of his friends continuously breathing down his neck. So if somebody wants to ask basic questions, if somebody wants to take his or her own individual time to grasp a particular concept, I guess it is very important to respect the same. And this is where I feel technology has a huge role to play. With so much of digitized content, with audiovisual learning, wherein quality education is accessible at a student's fingertips, it is easy for him or her to go through a particular concept n number of times before he is comfortable with it. Now, moving on, motivation can indeed help. I firmly believe that motivation can indeed help by bringing out the best in every student and create a world of opportunity. Indeed, technology, again, as I was telling you, has a role here in breaking barriers and democratizing education by making it accessible to one and all. So I firmly believe that, see, as far as technology is concerned, technology is only a bridge. It's only a catalyst. As I was telling you, basics of education will never change. Schools, I firmly believe, will always be first port of call. They will always be temples of learning. And there's no doubt about it that our teachers are doing a phenomenal job at what they do. They're doing a great job. So the role of technology or the role of edtech brands is to ensure that the good work that is done by our teachers, we should be able to ensure that this good work that they're doing should be able to reach, you know, students who need them the most. So breaking barriers, I guess that is first and foremost what technology needs to do. Now, moving on, this again is a very interesting case in point. If we just look back, we will see that some of our biggest innovators, you know, legendary entrepreneurs, spiritual gurus, have been school dropouts. Now, the point that I'm trying to make here, so I'm not trying to undermine the importance of education. You know, that's the last thing that I want to do. But the point that I'm trying to make here is that the time has come for education to be flexible enough to accommodate every unconventional school of thought and judge it on its merits rather than brushing it off under the carpet. The capability of these great men and women of substance were beyond doubt. And thus, the education system could have been more engaging and inclusive to accommodate them. Now, why I'm raising this point is because I firmly believe that education needs to be engaging enough. So learning should be fun. When a child is trying to learn a particular concept, education should be attractive enough. It should be a pleasure. It should be a soothing experience. Hence, at Notebook, what we aspire to do is, when we work on a particular topic, we always give a lot of thought in order to ensure that concepts like augmented storytelling, beautiful background music, hand-drawn illustrations are brought in. So learning is a lifelong process. It's an immersive journey. And I firmly believe that once a particular child gets interest in a topic, rest will naturally follow. Hence, this is where education needs to really step up and ensure that any child who is disengaged, any child who is not getting adequate amount of interest, he or she may be very talented, but it's our role as educators, as stakeholders in the whole process to ensure that we make education engaging enough for them. Now, this is where I guess the role of imagination comes in, you know. In this present hour, what we need is a learning community which encourages imagination and experimentation. Now, experiment, that's another word which is very important. We should encourage our children to have the courage to experiment. Let them fail, let them come back. Failure is only a stepping stone to success. But education system should encourage these two words, imagination and experimentation. Now, moving on, as I was telling you, that one of the things that really worries me most is peer pressure. That really worries me most. Peer pressure, continuous comparisons, I don't feel they do any good. So what we should do and what we have tried to do at Notebook is that we do collect a lot of behavioral data in terms of how a child is accessing the content, which are the topics of interest. And we do compare, we do analyze the behavior of a child vis-a-vis his or her peers. The objective is not to grade a child, but the objective is to understand where the gap is. Thus, data analytics and interpretation can help in building customized learning and motivate students to excel in a world where they do not compete with anyone other than themselves. Now, this is very important. Every tomorrow has to be better than today. So what is very important is that we encourage them to be better than what they are. Now, I believe in creating a world where each student learns in his or her own way. Because as you see, you know, just like adults, every child is a unique individual. So I'm sure all of them are gifted and talented. Just that we need to appreciate the fact that each one of them have their own individual learning patterns. Moving on, what is most important, I believe, is that they need to be happy and satisfied in the process. Learning should be fun. So once you're happy about something that you're doing, success is bound to follow. And not the other way around. So what is most important is that we are able to bring in this element of happiness in the whole process. Now, when I see during this lockdown, last few weeks, because keep on interacting with so many schools, principals, teachers, parents. So I see that even during this hour of crisis, when children are locked at home, they're not being able to go to school, meet their teachers, meet their friends. I see teachers really stepping up to the occasion, doing a phenomenal job at it, you know. So all doubts and debates that were there with regard to teachers adopting technology, stepping up, have been put to rest. So I believe this element of effort has brought in a sense of security and happiness. Students do feel connected. They feel teachers taking care of them. Parents do feel connected. Now, if we look at things a little holistically, what we aspire to create is far beyond marks or grades. See, the role of education cannot be confined to percentiles, cannot be confined to marks or grades. That's one way of looking at it. Yeah, we do live in a practical and competitive world where in order to go to the next step, we do need an assessment with regard to the earlier one. That's how it works. Having said that, the role of education is much broader than that. What we aspire to create is far beyond marks or grades. The importance of inculcating the right set of values, I guess, that is most important, by making them feel loved and secured. So every child needs to feel secured. We love them for who and what they are. And so that, I guess, is of most importance. Once a child is secure, once he or she knows that irrespective of marks or grade, teachers and parents are there to encourage them, to nurture them, to mentor them, I'm sure they'll do better. Now, I think true success, you know, lies in creating a legacy that outlives us far beyond our years. That, I guess, is very important. To create a system, to create a school of pedagogy, to leave a mark. Because the role a great teacher has in shaping up the mind, the career, and the character of a new young learner is second to none. We all remember great teachers at school who had contributed immensely to our, not only to our education, but also to our upbringing as a whole. So this is, I think, something which is very important. I thank you all for giving me a patient hearing. Over to you, Shubhayu.
Thank you, Achin. Thank you for introducing us to the thought process and the ethos that led to the creation of Notebook. Before we move on to the next speaker, let me once again request everybody to use the Q&A button at the bottom of their screens to please type in their questions instead of raising their hands so that we can moderate them better at the end of this session. Moving on, we get to our next speaker, Swami Supradeeptananda. I have an interesting story about Swamiji. I had a few months back taken my car and driven across the length of India to meet as many schools as possible. The first meeting that I had in the city of Gwalior was with Swamiji. And I was expecting to meet somebody who was devout and perhaps needed greater handholding in understanding the role of technology. I was taken aback by meeting somebody who, besides a very strong spiritual foundation, also was extremely tech savvy. You would be taken aback by the Fitbit on his hand or the way he uses his mobile phones and the way he gives out advice regarding any technology that you can use. Swamiji is the principal of the Ramakrishna Mission CBSE school in Gwalior and the director at the Ramakrishna Mission Madhya Pradesh Board School also in Gwalior. He has fulfilled multiple roles across the Ramakrishna Mission schools, including the schools in Gwalior and Arunachal Pradesh. Swamiji holds a master's degree in computer science and leads the charge when it comes to adoption of technology amongst schools in and around Gwalior. He is also a director of the Sharda Balgram, Gwalior, which is a residential institution for underprivileged children. Swamiji, over to you.
Hello, Shubhayu, can you hear me?
Yes, sir, we can hear you.
Okay. Thank you all of you for inviting me over here to present this presentation regarding to the Together for the Education. This is a national seminar for which we feel honored to be invited over here. And the aim is how to keep student motivated, isn't it? Nowadays, what is happening is that this due to Corona and lockdown, some unprecedented scenario has erupted. And in order to tackle that, there was no other option but to move for the digitalization. And in order to do that, there were various challenges in front of us when we actually thought of the digitalization. In classroom digitalization, it was okay. But for the student, digitalization from their home was an actual challenge. Thus, this digitalization can be divided into the five main points, that is the scope of digitalization, then stakeholders, then actual challenges, feedback, remedy, and rectification. In scope of digitalization, we can divide it into two parts, that is the classroom digitalization. I think most of our schools have adopted with the classroom digitalization, but for the classes from home, this is something unique and new, which we never dreamed about also. But this Corona have brought this opportunity for us to shift ourselves and adjust according to the situation. So in the classroom digitalization, this presentation is specially devoted for the technical aspect of the digitalization, right? As well as the successful implementation of the digitalization. So classroom digitalization can be divided into the various parts. First is the online services. Within that online services, there are various aspects that which we have to take care of. The first is the syllabus mapping. All the syllabus, whatever text materials we have, that has to be mapped on the software, and the soft copy is always should be ready either in your server or on the online for the easy access of the student as well as teachers. Then simply text material won't do. In order to drive the point into the minds of the students, the video plays a very vital role. So comparative videos must be available with the which are directly related to the subjects. Then use of online whiteboard. This is something unique thing. Till now, the teacher used to use blackboard as well as chalk. But instead of that, this digital blackboard and digital chalk, they can use. And whatever they want to draw over there, whatever color they want to use, they can use it and make the classroom very interesting. Then online annotation also are the tools over there available, which we can use whenever it is necessary. After interacting with the student on a specific subject, the teacher have the very quick access of the mind of the student by making them to appear for the quiz. This quiz gives teacher an insight whether the student have understood the subject properly or not. And after that, they can once again revise the topic which the student might be feeling very difficult. And at home also, for home assignment, they can provide the worksheet. Through online worksheet also, they can provide. Then problem solving, regarding to the problem solving, as we say, we have seen the raising of the hand over here. So online teaching also, there is ample scope for student to ask their question and get their problem solved. Then online classroom from home, this is something new feature that we have to address. We in our school, both the schools, we successfully conducted this online classes from the home. So certain aspects are there which has to be taken care of. They are the use of gadget and computers by the students as well as teachers, then regular lectures by the teachers, then home assignment by the teachers, whatever home assignment, because student is not in front of you, and how you are going to give them home assignment, that was a challenge. And after giving the home assignment also, how you are going to check, that was the another challenge. And in between, there is a third challenge, that is the uploading of the answer sheet by the student. So all these things can be coupled together, and if nicely synchronized, it will be a great help for the teaching community as well as student community as well as other stakeholders also. Then evaluated answer sheet can also be made available for the parents as well as student for their understanding where actually they had made the mistakes. Then stakeholders, there are four major stakeholders, that is the school management and teachers, parents as well as students. The most important part is of school management. Decision makers, they are the decision makers, they are on the driving seat, they take decisions and get the things done through various stakeholders, that is the teachers, parents as well as students. While doing that, certain thing has to be taken care of, that is the first layer, the anxiety factor of the teacher must be removed first. Then the parents' permission, you can say, or parents' willingness to make parent ready for this, because parent has to pay for the digitalization in two forms. One is the internet charges, at the same time the purchase of the gadget. And they are unsure whether their child will be using that gadget in the proper way. So in order to remove that anxiety, the school management as well as teacher has to work over time so that to bring them overboard. And the students, there is no problem about the students. Students are ready for digitalization. Every time they want to go for mobile and computer, and they are engrossed over there. So that this last stakeholder, that is the student, we need not have to worry. Only worry is that to hold him back during the online classes. Then actual challenges, the willingness of the stakeholders. As I said, the management must be ready for digitalization. Then teacher, student as well as parents, they must be come on the same platform and cooperate or communicate with each other for the success of the digitalization. Then gadgets, how and what gadgets you are using, what gadget parents are giving to the student, that is another aspect, where if your gadget is not okay and more than one time it is getting hanged or hacked by the other persons, then it will be a very serious problem for the smooth conduction of the things, and whole thing will fall into the pieces when there is no synchronization, because every student or every parent will keep on asking the question to the parent, okay, these are the problem, how to solve it, and on online or on time, in time, if we are not able to solve that problem, then the discouragement may erupt in the atmosphere. So that has to be taken care of. Then good internet connection. The internet connection having, that is no issue nowadays in India, but having a good internet, that is definitely a serious issue, because when the child is uploading the thing and if your data is exhausted or if you don't have the electricity at that time, some problem may come. But anyway, if good internet connection is there, the data can be uploaded and downloaded very quickly, and it gives a pleasant experience for the listener or the observer as well as student as well as teachers. Then holding back to the student, this is most important thing, because in a class we can hold back them together and make them listen what you want to say, but when the students are at home, it is very difficult to manage them. One solution it came in my mind, ki if the parents are the going for the job and student is alone at home, at that time student may not be present over there, some student are present and another student might not be there. We have also came across with this type of problem, ki in some period there were certain X number of student, in another period, immediately sixth period, there was missing some student, some new student have come. So this can be handled by taking attendance at the beginning of each classes. And we need not have to send that SMS to almost all the parents, but we can arrange or we can make the provision for sending the SMS to those parents whose student or whose ward is absent during that specific period. And in this way, that deterrence is there in place, so immediately the student will not dare to be absent even by being at home without the supervision of their parent. Then remedy and rectification. When all the system is at place, it is very difficult to say ki now everything is okay and now we are in the comfort zone, let us have sit together, have a tea and chat. No, because remedies or the problem, God knows from which direction the problem will come, isn't it? And accordingly, if you don't give the timely remedy, helping hand over there, those scene becomes very gloomy. So for that purpose, what might be the problems coming in advance, if we can think about it, and the rectificational plan or the documentation is ready, immediately we can provide those documents with the parent as well as student, even to the teachers also. Sometimes what happens ki if any parent is not able to connect their ward with the teacher, immediately teacher has to look towards somewhere else. So there must be that provision to ask someone person online to help the parent on the spot itself, so that that person will tackle that parent and the regular classes will be continued. And then these are the certain remedies and rectification that is applicable for all the points. That is for the school management also, it is equally applicable. Then earmarking budget, that is one of the important thing, because now every school is striving for the cash because of this corona, there is no fund flow. And that is another biggest challenge for the school management to decide whether we should go for the digitalization or not. But even after that also, there are so many agencies which can provide the funds and everything. We can go for that. We can go for by earmarking that fund. But after all, the payment back is another issue. So these thing has also to be think of by the school management. Then parent consent. As I said, some parent might be apprehensive about giving the gadgets to the student. That has to be addressed. The simple remedy, what came in our mind is that, for example, if the parent is going to give gadget for 15,000 to their ward, so that 50 and that student is in class 5 and he will be studying it till the degree level, if we can divide that 5 years or 7 years of education, so hardly it accounts for the 2,000 per year. Another option we have given, that is a funny option. I just suggested to the student, if you have a money crunch, you just go ask your parent for only 2,000. Ask your mother for 2,000. Ask your dadaji for 2,000. In this way, collect from all of them and purchase the gadget. Because the moment that gadget comes in the hand of the student, the sky is the limit for the study. So many things, online things are ready to solve their problem. There are certain softwares also which provide 24/7 online helping hand. There is no necessary for moving outside of the house even, simply by having a simple gadget. In this way, if we can convince to the parents about purchasing the gadget, it will be a great help not only to the student, but also for the teachers as well as management for the smooth conduction of the academic study whole year. Then selection of the perfect vendors. This is something tricky, because when school vendor or some vendor knows ki this school is going for the digitalization, almost all from all the side they flock towards it, and then it becomes very puzzling. Everybody is offering so many things, but exactly to choose a perfect vendor and the services after that, that is a very challenging task, but with the help of experts, we can also go through, navigate ourselves through it. Then efficient troubleshooting. As I said, on the classroom front, on the teacher front, at the same time on the vendor front, on the parent front, at the same time on the social media front, you have to be very much responsive and sensitive so that anything comes in front of you, the right and exactly user satisfying attitude must be over there. So that aspect is not anywhere less than others. Then under the remedy and rectification stakeholders, the syllabus mapping. Sometimes we get the syllabus, everything done, it is launched, everything, and some problem may come. Some problem, there might be the mismatch of the pages, there might be the wrong problem solving for a question, there might be the another way also, two, three steps might be there to have the answer of the specific question. So at that time, we can suggest, teacher can suggest through management to the vendor, you have certain changes, and accordingly, when they get the changes, it becomes updated. This should be the constant process. Then handholding. As I said, handholding we need for all the stakeholders, not only for the parent, student, as well as teacher, but to the management also. There must be some person who should give the right decision making at right time. Then flexibility of use of various educational websites. Sometimes what happens, management gives only restricted access to the teacher for in the teaching in the class, so that the internet charges will be more, the more data will be spent over there in that way. But that is not the way to handle the situation. Whatever things are necessary other than outside of your mapped content, that must be accessible easily for the teachers, so that in order to explain the things from all the 365 degree, that will be a best way to teach to the student. Because the picture from almost all the side, if we give, then only we can understand exactly that what that thing is actually. Then distance learning. This is a sort of distance learning. We are sitting over here conducting webinar, all people from their respective places, they are attending the things. But at the same time, conventionally, what we used to do is that we used to invite some expert. He used to travel from Delhi, Bombay side, and then he will be staying over there. There is a loss of time for him also for traveling and everything. Then he will come, and only for limited time he will come. He will come for 1 or 2 period he will take and he will go. The rest of the school is devoid of his knowledge, isn't it? So this distance learning, if the facility is made available, we can make it available from almost all the student at a glance, right from class 1 to class 12. There might be the situation key. For example, we are doing a certain session for class 7, but class 5 parent might also be interested to understand what exactly it will be going for, because his ward is going to come into class 7. So in this way, not only specifically, till now conventionally we used to focus upon only specific class, the specific parent, but now it has been thrown overboard for almost all the people. Even the parent of a child who is studying in class 1, he can also understand the insight of the school mechanism, and in this way he can have the faith in the school. And in this way, there is very less chance of students leaving the school also. Then distance learning, security. Security is a very important aspect, as I said, when parents are very much anxious, other than educational website, the student might be misusing when the parents are not around. So at that time, we can have the security check for them. We can give the student a limited access to certain website, and that's all. And in this way, that anxiety also can be taken care of. From the management point of view, there should not be the breach of whenever there is the class going on and some another third party entering over there. So if such condition arises, there must be the mechanism in place to handle this type of situation. We can eliminate that person from that online lecture permanently also. And in this way, the security, there was so much of anxiety regarding to certain app, that app is not providing that app is not foolproof. But it is not like that. Every app is providing all those remedial aspects also taken care of over there. Then the actual challenges, efficient time management. As I said, if one teacher when it leaves, another teacher must be over there because parents and everybody is looking and your school's prestige is at stake. So we have to make encourage our teacher to come overboard in time and leave the period in time so that they can conduct their class in another section also. So that is one thing. Then plan B. For every success, there must be the plan B ready. For example, if teacher is not over there because of illness or certain untoward situation, if any teacher is not coming on the day, that class should not be empty. So immediately stopgap arrangement must be provided and that alternate teacher must be given over there, provided over there to the student. That alternate teacher also can use the time, extra time in various ways by giving them exposure in other than academics, what is going on around world affair and all that thing. So that plan B is also can be taken care of. Then reporting of the errors and getting solution. This is very much important. Because as I said, key technical issues are there. The teacher just inform it to the management. Management inform to the vendor. Vendor inform to the his engineer. And somehow or another, that engineer is not coming or he left the job. And this thing, the whole cycle remains in a half halted in certain somewhere else. But that has to be taken care to the its legitimate end, and that. Error reporting as well as getting solution. Unless and until we get the solution, we should not sit idly. This culture has to be imbibed into the mind of the management as well as teachers, as well as vendors. They must be accountable. They must be sensitive because that is not the issue of any teacher or any school management, because that student might be suffering. He might be worrying about that. That sensitivity must be inculcated into almost all the stakeholders in order to reduce the friction. And that can be done through love. As Swamiji says, the love is the great lubricant that can smoothen almost all the functioning of this great mechanism, great machine called the world mechanism. Then patience and perseverance, as I said, in order to have the bouncers in the cricket language. In order to absorb the bouncers, we must have the patience. We must keep ourselves cool so that to tackle the next ball. Likewise, there might be some bouncers upon the teachers, upon the management, upon the stakeholders. But if the love is over there among all of them, everything can be handled very comfortably. Then constant upgradation, isn't it? Life is a series of progress. We have to keep on pedaling. Likewise, the upgradation in our knowledge, upgradation in technology, upgradation in syllabus, upgradation in thought patterns, everything is equally applicable for all the stakeholders. Then the user satisfaction. This is the last thing, isn't it? Whatever you are doing, and if the parent and teacher parent and students are not comfortable with, so whole thing become hodgepodge. In order to avoid that, every aspect of or the every feedback from the student as well as parent must be taken with the 100% seriousness, and that feedback has to be reviewed. Not that after taking feedback we just throw it away in the dustbin and just it is a off time and let us run back to the home. Not like that. We have to keep it at the back of our mind, and unless and until we solve it, we should not sit together. And if we have this type of mentality, I don't think in any class, in any part of the world, this online digitalization will be a failure. Then advanced notification is another thing. We want to get the things done, but we don't provide the ample sufficient time for the parent as well as student to think over it. isn't it? So advanced notification system must be in place. Then timely, efficient support system for student and parent, that I have said more than once also. If you give timely relief to any parent or student, they remain very much grateful. And after that, even if you commit some blunder, some mistake, so that parent and teacher are very much large-heartedly, they can overlook that type of shortcomings within it. But after all, as I said, as a spiritual person or spiritual Swami, as I can say, the spirituality blended with technology will make this world more pleasant, more comfortable to live in. Thank you. Thank you to all.
Thank you so much, Swamiji, for those enlightening words. As I told everybody in your introduction, I'm sure everybody else is wondering the same thing that I did after meeting you, that you're perhaps sitting at this perfect intersection of spirituality and latest technology. Thank you. Thank you so much. Moving on, before we get to the panel discussion that we have for you today, we will take a few minutes to tell you about Notebook as a product and our thought process behind adopting the technology.
How can we use digital learning to very small?
Mr. Bharat, sir, I believe your mic is unmuted. So for any technology to be really adopted well, to really make a difference in people's lives, there are two things that are important. One is for it to be useful. It should solve the problem that you are adopting it for. If you have downloaded an app to call a cab, it should call a cab. If you have downloaded an app to order food, it should help you order food, and so on. But a second very important aspect is the ease of use. The app has to be easy enough, intuitive enough to navigate and to use. This formed the foundation of our choice in technology. Notebook's technology is in partnership with Google. We work with Google for storage, data analytics, and video streaming. And we adopt a very simple three-step process for any student who's trying to learn with Notebook. You simply log in using either a username and password that you get through your school or using a mobile number. Currently, we want to support every school, every student out there during this time of the crisis. And we have therefore kept all login for free. Once you log in, you select your class, your subject. And within that subject, very similar to YouTube, you find the video that you want to watch and go over and start playing it. What I will try to do now is give you a very short demo of how you can navigate Notebook for the benefit of all the teachers, the parents, and the others that we have on this call today. When you log on to Notebook, this is the screen that you would be looking at. Once you click on login, you provide a username. This is available with most of you, and this gives you free access. The password is 1234, and you click on login. Once that is done, you enter into the class of your choice. Since it is now open access for everybody, we typically land on class 10. You can go over to My Subject, choose whichever class you want to study from, and the subject you want to study. Within a few seconds, all the topics according to the NCERT CBSE curriculum for that class and subject would appear. You select the topic that you want to study, and the video would start to play.
The revolution has always been in the hands of the young. The young always inherit the revolution. Huey Newton.
Managing the video playout is very easy. It is like YouTube or any other video playing software that you've ever used. Every topic is broken down into multiple learning vectors. This that you're watching on your screens right now is the interest builder to give people an idea of what a revolution is all about. And then there are lesson videos where the lesson has been split into three parts. A short recap video that helps students revise the chapter just before an exam or maybe the evening after the class. And a set of questions and answers. What we have also done is try to balance between the need for knowledge and the need to score well in exams, as we know both are equally important. So for classes which are closer to board years, that is classes 9 to 12, we have also provided textual notes and question answers. You can open any of the notes, and that would give you an exhaustive understanding of that entire topic. What we have also done is for certain boards, for example, for the UP State Board, we have used vernacular language in our teaching. Today is Rabindranath Tagore's birthday. To honor him, we will quickly play out a short portion from one of his writings, Kabuliwala. This is part of the UP State Board syllabus. What you would realize is we first do a synopsis, which is completely in Hindi.
बच्चों आज हम जिस कहानी को पढ़ेंगे उसका नाम है काबुलीवाला। इस कहानी के लेखक श्री रविंद्रनाथ टैगोर हैं। रविंद्रनाथ टैगोर को साहित्य।
After the Hindi synopsis, the lesson video comprises of both English as well as Hindi, and then there is a recap completely in English so that there's a handholding for the student from all Hindi to all English. Today the platform boasts of around 2.5 lakh active users. We have partnered with over 600 schools across the country who have been providing links for our content to their students. One of the things students have been doing for online education is the link that you see on top here. This can be copied and pasted onto a WhatsApp message. And schools have been sending these links on WhatsApp to their students and asking students to write 250 to 300 word summaries of these topics. And it's been such a brilliant use of this platform for taking regular online classes. The videos are deliberately kept very short. As you would see, most videos are 6 to 10 minutes in length. This is to ensure that we do not occupy more than 25% of any 40 minute class. Also, when a student is learning at home, the videos need to be short and crisp without repetition so that they can hold the attention of the student for the entire duration. We have been very fortunate in the kind of appreciation that we have received from many quarters. We recently won the Economic Times Now, the ET Now Award for the best app and website in the education category. We were also invited to Abu Dhabi as the only Indian brand to interact with their government and discussing on how new companies like ourselves can be of aid to a global population. All of this has been popular by and large due to the fantastic team we have. Today we have about 150 people who work with us, some within the office, some from remote locations. These 150 people have been working tirelessly over the last so many months to ensure that the best and the most engaging educational content can be made available to your students and children. That was it from the demo. We will now move on to the part that I know a lot of you have been waiting for eagerly. We have today a very enviable panel for this discussion. The topic of the discussion is how to keep students motivated during a crisis. For the panel we have with us today, Rubina Sanyal, who's the school counselor for the Lamartinier for Boys School in Kolkata. We have Anna Ghosh, who's a child therapist with the Ummeed Child Development Center in Mumbai. She finished her master's in consulting psychology from the Tata Institute of Social Sciences, TIS. And we have Mr. Sanam Yeleswara Rao, who is a principal at the St. Peter's Edu School in Warangal. Abhishek, can we please unmute the speakers? Done. Mr. Rao, Ms. Ghosh and Ms. Sanyal, are you there?
Yes.
To begin with, we would go around the table once for introductory comments. I would ask you to keep this brief and within 3 minutes if possible. We have Mr. Rao, who runs a school in Warangal. He's also MSc Mathematics, MSc Statistics, along with a BEd. He has been a trainer and educator, especially in the field of mathematics for many, very many years. Sir, what we would ask from you is to tell us what is the kind of challenges that you as a school principal are facing during this lockdown when the schools are closed, especially with the students' motivation levels during this crisis. Over to you, sir.
First of all, good evening to everyone. Thanks to the Notebook Management keeping this wonderful section. As you know that nowadays online teaching for schools, especially primary, secondary and senior secondary, this is the most important tool. Now we are facing the so many problems regarding this one, online teaching. So as a primary, we are doing that posting videos only. We are not doing that any other part. But secondary and as well as the senior secondary, we are doing the live classes also, using with the different technologies. So sometimes some of the students are teachers using the Zoom and Google Meet and Cisco apps and all that, and Skypes also. But here the problem is that only not only teacher side, even the parent and student side also. Gadgets are not available. One gadget in one room, one home, two students are there at a time, classes going on. How we can adjust this, all that one by one is there. So that's why in our school, we did that one standard practice. We created completely Google Classrooms and keep it that all the videos and everything and post in a Google Classrooms step by step. And whenever students free, they can join the Google Classrooms and taking that all the things and step by step away and taking that one, complete the works and return to that once again to the teachers. Like that, we can use that in our school Google Classrooms very well. This Google Classrooms are connecting with the Google Meet, as well as that we can go to the Jamboards and teaching the students very well. And the next one is that here we can take it the Google attendance sheets and all, we can take it that and applying that attendance every day also, we are collecting that with the Google only. And where most of the students in our school, most of the students, including my daughter and also following the notebook videos. Very clearly, we can give that hand stuff to the notebook and giving that very wonderful platform. Students are very interesting about the Google, this notebook videos and all. Not only now, this period, and previously last year, my daughter also saw that last 8 months onwards, we are following the Google notebook, especially social and English. In 10th standard, she took that, we adapted that one very well. Like that, just first I join as a parent, next I can apply in my school also this notebook platform. And coming to this, schools has integrated as LMS with the ERP. What is that LMS ERP? Learning Management System completely need to adapt that nowadays the schools. That is, attendance need to take that through without the gadgets, they're taking the attendance, and assignments also need to conduct that without paper, and monitoring need required that without paper and all, and a submission of that also can require the without paper, assessments and everything need to following that different manners. And so total system need to modify it. No other way we can have that now. This corona period gives to that very clearly indications to us need to change that modification. So that's why in the month of May and June, we can take it a short interval period and keep it that very effective goals. That is that one is implementing that online classes with the tools and motivate that parents and students very clearly towards that online classes. Next one, administrative elements, online syllabus, timetable. The timetable is also very flexible to the student. And most of the students are unable to attend that in a particular time. So that's why flexibility of the timetable is very, very important for not only student, not only teacher, both of the requirement. So we doing that our side, encourage the parents, teachers and students and keeping the motivation, all the things. And these online classes give that so many challenges. That is that challenging the students mindset also. Some of the parents saying that if you give the gadgets, what will happen? Our speakers told now, we have to take that very clearly all the steps. Yes, we are facing a lot of issues and slowly we can convey the parents towards that motivation, because Warangal is nowadays totally 50 CBSE schools and totally 150 state board schools are there here. And all the schools, first school is that our school, St. Peter's School, started that all the things here. and we can give that effectively applications to the not only students, not only teachers, parents, and we can motivate the principals also towards that this digitalization situation. Now the my question is how we can motivate the students to adopt this is only the way is counseling them. There is no other option with us. We need to counsel the students step by step and parents, and we can go to the next levels. That's a Thank you so much, sir.
We will move over to Ms. Ruvena Sanyal next. Ruvena Sanyal is a consulting psychologist. She is the senior school counselor at La Martinia for Boys, Kolkata. She is also a consultant for child and adolescent mental health issues. She conducts training programs and workshops for teachers, parents, and students, and has been associated with the leadership program for principals run by the Council for Indian School Certificate Examinations. Ruvena, over to you.
Thank you, Mr. Roy. A very good evening to all the listeners today. I would like to, at the very onset of this discussion, bring our focus back to the human element that we are all concerned about, the students themselves. And I would like to begin by highlighting some of the factors that may serve to explain why children are either undermotivated or demotivated in our classrooms today. I think the most important thing that needs to be kept in mind at this moment is that we are not physically present in the classroom. We are all locked down at home. And if the school has not made uniforms mandatory, then you often have children lounging around in their PJs and in their night suits, relaxing in the comfort of home. So you cannot blame them if the parameters of classroom and classroom learning are ceasing to exist, and if the boundaries that govern classroom behavior are gradually becoming blurred. Now I will add to this the prevailing pandemic situation. As adults, almost all of us are either at our thresholds of tolerance or have even passed our thresholds of tolerance. And we are looking at young minds, we are considering children. Let's also keep in mind that every home may not be a safe space for our young people today. We're looking at issues of alcoholism, domestic violence and abuse. We're also looking at the fear of or the actual loss of employment of parents, which may be their daily reality. And coming to an even smaller but relevant percentage of children in our schools, who are the so-called special learners, the ones who have every day of their learning lives grappled with psychological problems and learning difficulties, and who are now forced to adjust to this new situation that has suddenly cropped up, so to speak. Add to this the fact that children are witnessing or may even be participating, actively or passively, in discussions about the COVID-19 situation. So what are we looking at? We're looking at mood swings, anxiety, insecurity, fear, irritation, and moving on to anger, aggression, stemming from the frustration of the situation that we are all experiencing today. And if it is the adults who are experiencing these emotions, then can we blame the children for patterning on those emotions or mirroring them in their behavior and even acting out? No, we cannot. This is what is precipitating behavior problems in the online classrooms today. And teachers are therefore coming up with more and more instances of impulsivity, hyperactivity, low attention and low concentration, failing interest levels, and even more worrisome, severe disciplinary issues like the locker room case that has once again rocked the capital just a few days ago. So on the one hand, we have young people facing problems. On the other hand, we have a classroom to run. We can hope for increased parental involvement and support, but let's be practical. In most homes today, we would have one or even both parents working from home and then taking turns with other household chores as well. So parental supervision, even though it is desirable, is not guaranteed. Having said this, I would now like to bring our focus back to the question that is raised today at this panel discussion. What can we as educators do to motivate young learners in our online classrooms? Well, to take a leaf from our students' notebooks, as Aladdin and Jasmine sang, it's a whole new world. So as we ride the corona carpet into a whole new world of digital learning, we will now have to use different ways and means and techniques to see what will spark their interest, what will motivate them, and what will eventually work. And without being too preachy at the very outset, I would like to urge our teachers, educators, and facilitators to be very positive, to be patient, and to be proactive. And hopefully, as this discussion progresses, you will be able to pick up ways of motivating your young students. Thank you, Mr. Roy. Over to you.
Thank you, Ms. Anyal. Our next speaker is Ohana Ghosh. Ohana is a mental health practitioner who has been working at the Ummid Child Development Center, Mumbai, since 2018. She completed her master's in counseling psychology from Tata Institute of Social Sciences, Mumbai, where she was deeply influenced by understandings of intersections between the social, the cultural, and the political, and the profound impact existing systems have on people's identities and therefore their mental health. Ohana's work mostly centers around having conversations with children and families that is situated in the intersections of mental health, child development, disability, education, the larger socio-cultural context, and mental health. While working with a transdisciplinary team of pediatricians, occupational therapists, remedial educators, speech therapists, and others, allied professionals as part of a team at Ummid, she has also been working in collaboration with school systems to support inclusion and diversity in the larger social context, with a keen interest in research and advocacy. Ohana, over to you.
Thank you so much. And I think at the outset, I also want to thank everyone for this really enriching discussion that we've had so far. I think I've been sitting here furiously taking notes because there's been so much that has been emerging that has struck me or has been meaningful. I think I hope that in today's discussion, I'm somewhere able to hold true the voices of the young people and families that I consult with. And I'm hoping that in some ways I'm able to represent that and do justice to that as much as possible. I think working from a clinic setup, as compared to maybe Ruvena's context, where she's working in close contact with within the school system, I'm positioned outside of the school system, so to speak, in a way. However, I have the privilege of being in direct contact with young people and also with young people and families who experience neurodiversity and experience disability of varying kinds and who are still part of the school system and are navigating it. So I think they sort of have, in many ways, informed my practice and opened up my mind to possibilities of how learning can look like, how education can look like. And I will be drawing from that mostly in what I share today. I think today, as I was hearing everybody speak and also reflecting on today's theme, which is keeping students motivated, there were a lot of thoughts on my mind that kept sort of rushing past. And I think I was mostly curious about some of the metaphors that I heard our esteemed speakers share today. So one of which was engine, as Mr. Bharat had mentioned, and also the metaphor of clay modeling, as Mr. Bhattacharya had mentioned. And I was thinking about that a little more, and what was standing out in terms of my thought process was, I was curious about the roots of these metaphors, that are we in some ways sort of thinking about how students are passive recipients of motivation? Is motivation supposed to be, you know, sort of drilled into their systems? Is it supposed to be injected into their brains and their minds? And is that how we're supposed to operate as professionals and as educators to support our young people to go forth in the in learning, especially during these times? I'm also drawing heavily from what Ruvena said, and I resonate so much with what she said, is to locate education not just within students' life goals, but also to situate it within the context, in the larger context of what's happening right now in the eve of a pandemic that's sort of ripping our lives apart in different ways, to sort of reflect on the larger socio-political, cultural, economical discourses that we are constantly responding to, and how young people are also responding to them in their own ways. And as I was thinking along those lines, I was thinking about how perhaps the lack of motivation or demotivation or undermotivation that Savannah was saying, are they perhaps responses, responses to this this pandemic, responses to these unfamiliar, uncharted territories? And are they also in some ways a larger response? Is there a message perhaps that we should perhaps tune into as educators and allied professionals about what is perhaps not seeming okay about the way we are imparting education, out the way where we have been doing it so far? And perhaps is this an opportune moment for us to rethink what education can look like? I was so happy to hear so many ideas come up in the past hour and a half, thinking about, you know, teachers assuming the position of co-researchers, about students sort of taking charge of their own education, of taking charge of more goal-directed learning, setting their own goals, moving towards that, bringing in flexibility that supports their learning in a way that's respectful of their style of learning, that's respectful of what they prefer to learn, and is also respectful of the pace in which they want to learn. And all of these things sort of made me think about another thing, which I think Swamiji pointed out, which was about access to technology. And I'm thinking about all of these factors, you know, that are sort of interacting with one another, about mental health, about how children are experiencing so much of restlessness, so much of uncertainty, and what that could mean in the face of using technology as a means to learn. What could be certain modalities, therefore, that we can think about that would suit them best? And keeping in mind that we're also in a social context where there are layers and layers of privilege, and privilege in many ways sort of either enables us or restricts us from access to resource. So access to an online medium, access to a phone, access to a stable internet connection, access to online mediums of learning can also be a privilege for a section of society, and could also become marginalizing for others who do not have the access to such resources. And therefore, to think about what could learning look like for them and what could motivation look like for them. Does that mean that young people have stopped learning? Or does that mean that young people are redirecting their minds to learn things differently, or perhaps are learning different things that are not in textbooks, or that are not part of our syllabus or our curriculum? And what possibilities does that open up for us as educators, and not just at the micro level in terms of teachers, heads of schools and parents, but I'm also thinking in the larger macro context of education policies, curriculum design, and so forth. So yeah, really, really looking forward to what else we can unpack in our discussion. Thank you so much.
Thank you, Ohana. Ruvena, Ohana raised a very interesting point there. She says that we are perhaps not doing justice to the students in saying that they need to be motivated externally, and we should perhaps rely more on an internal locus of control that lets the student also be an active participant in the process.
Yes.
To me, coming from outside in, sounds a little counterintuitive, because the whole idea behind motivation is to have somebody develop the will to do something by themselves. If I could have your thoughts.
No, absolutely. So reiterating what she said, there is no vaccine for motivation. We can try as we might, but there is actually no vaccine for motivation. Motivation is inherently intrinsic. It's like you can take the horse to the water and you can end that statement yourself. So the point that I would like to highlight here is that when we look at motivation, there are just two aspects to it. extrinsic and intrinsic. So what is it that Ohana and myself are getting at? We're talking about intrinsic motivation, which basically is the motivation that comes from within to perform an activity for its own sake. It's because of the personal inherent rewards that you will attain by engaging in that activity solely. So we're talking about pleasure, we're talking about the sense of achievement, we're talking about success, we're talking about an enhancement of skills, and all of that will happen when the child is engaging in that activity on his own. So therefore, what are we talking about when we're talking about motivation in the classroom? That brings us to extrinsic motivation, which is the motivation to perform, which usually is spurred on because the child wants to earn a reward or to avoid a punishment. So that is what takes us towards the entire school system of, you know, grading and marks and getting certificates and winning medals. And on the other end of the spectrum, we're looking at the ones who are not so successful and who possibly need to repeat a class. So this is what we're looking at in its entirety, the extrinsic and intrinsic motivation. So I think in the current scenario, we're looking at teachers trying to strike a balance between both. Is there a way? I am not saying there is, and neither am I saying there isn't. What we're asking is there a way in which we can introduce activities and learning processes wherein a child can enjoy the activity and achieve a level of intrinsic satisfaction and motivation, and through it also have awards accruing, either directly or indirectly, consciously or unconsciously, coming to him, which will spur him on to the next level of achievement.
Thank you. Thanks so much for that. Mr. Rao, if you could come back to you.
Yes.
We are currently living within a lockdown for the schools. The schools have still not opened. We don't know when they'll open. However, it is a rising concern that what will happen once the schools do open? There could be restrictions, there could be social distancing norms that schools would have to operate under. And given any kind of restrictions when you subject students to them, there's a natural drop in the motivation levels. Would you want to take your shot at what school structures would be like once they do reopen after this lockdown?
Yeah, it's a big challenging nowadays. Everyone searching that new answers for the same questions. New answers for same questions. Why new answers for same questions means, until the Indian education system, 90% is a board and chalk and board. Now, all of the children convert into digitalization. So teacher need to modify it and the school need to modify it. And once, after this, a lockdown period over, once again come back to the school, the teacher, the student, and everything need to maintain that distance, this social distance, not transfer that anything. First of all, diary should not be transferred. So digital diary implemented. The next one is no examination, because question paper should not be transferred. So there is that digitalization examination system required. And correction of notebooks. So this is again big problem with that regular classes, correction of notebooks. And the other problem is touching the students. So how we can maintain that? This is that now everyone is thinking that once we open that school, how we can maintain the school. So there are that certain parts everyone thinking that first digitalization. The second part is that making that every teacher training, online trainings, very clearly how to adjust this new situations and all. So the teacher should using that technology as well as that teaching, board teaching required that at after that during this lockdown. So after you sorry in this lockdown period, what is happening that totally different situation is going to face that after the lockdown. So in this format, the long-term goals for digitalization is required that, and making online is a part of that as usual way of working. So for example, total school make it as a two parts, and given that 3 days is a one to fifth standard, And the rest of days, you can give that other classes permission. Like that, we can give the most flexible timetable and a flexible teaching methodologies. We can apply that. Because group activity should not be doing that. You have to think about that group activity, other activities, and individual activities, you have to plan it. And also that physical education, you can modify it in a different modifications. So already government are initiating the so many things, but by practicing, daily practicing situation, it's a so headache conditions we can face it definitely. So in this one, we are also new thing for this one. We are ready to moderate ourselves, and we are ready to give that so many new tools and new things, day-to-day searching for the new applications, how we can face this problem after the COVID-19. So planning of that new normal, everything we can plan that in a different way. That one more very important application is that marks, until we are in that mark scenario. So marks and mark scenario, instead of that mark scenario, we have to go to that in a different application. That is skill-based application we require that. The entire assessment system, self-assessment system is converted into skill-based. So in this skill-based oriented, a lot of hurdles are there until that. Recognition of the parents are important, and the recognition of the teacher is very important. And so many different skills are there inside the student. We need to cope up that all the things in a different way to get that progress of the student. So the progress also need to change that. The curriculum need to change that. The syllabus need to change that. The examination pattern also need to change that. So these all the things completely change it, and we can give that a fun, complete fun, freedom to the teacher to inside the classroom, as well as that to parent as well as a student inside the home. We can give the freedom and flexibility, then only we can cope up this COVID-19 situation. Thank you.
Thank you so much, sir. What I would like to do is, since so far we have heard about the challenges in the current lockdown situation, we've heard about expected challenges once the lockdown gets over, and in the spirit of notebook, we would definitely want people to have tangible takeaways from the discussion. So in your closing remarks, I would come to Ohana first. If I had to ask you to give me 5 things that a teacher needs to do to ensure that the student is motivated and not distracted while taking online classes from home, what are the 5 things that you would recommend? Sort of a handbook.
This gives me so much to think about. And I think I will be also be drawing from so much that has already been shared as well. I would start with talking about something that Mr. Bharat has shared about teachers bringing in excitement into their process. There is this idea that we often practice in our work, in my practice, in therapeutic practice, where we talk about the idea of performing hope or bringing in excitement deliberately in our processes as a way to often hold together something that would otherwise be too fragile or that would otherwise break too easily. So in the sense, in terms of engaging children online, is to bring in that kind of excitement, that kind of warmth, that sort of personal connect where teachers are maybe just doing one round of just checking with each child in person how they've been, one or sharing one or two things with them. That could be something. So excitement is one. Second would be definitely, I think, switching up the format a bit. So bringing in a bit of games, bringing in a bit of humor, play, bringing in, I think, as we were discussing earlier, is that bringing in real life examples to tether learning into something that is meaningful and tangible for young people. The third would be, I think, flexibility, as Mr. Rao was rightfully speaking about, as I resonate so much with that idea, is that the idea that children should have the agency to choose how much they want to engage and when they want to engage with any learning materials, so to speak, and the fact that even they, if they are not part of a live classroom, that they can always engage with it differently. For classrooms to have like backups, or for classroom sessions to have recordings, so that young people can go back to it and have access to it. Perhaps that could be a way. Apart from that, what I was always also wondering is, sometimes also consulting with young people, checking with them before a classroom session starts in terms of what they would like to do, maybe switching it up a bit, taking upon that stance of a co-researcher, doing projects with them, doing assignments with them, where students get to prepare something on their own and then come and take a class themselves, perhaps, for the rest of the class, or share something along the topic that is, you know, the topic of discussion for that day. And maybe the last thing that I would say is similar to what Ruvena said earlier, is to bring in that patience, that there will be good days and there will be bad days. There will be days when young people will want to engage in a certain way, but there will be days when they're also responding to so many other things that it might get overwhelming to be part of the classroom. And there may be challenges, and it's okay. Perhaps this is how the new normal is going to look like for us going forward. So, yeah, those are the five takeaways, perhaps, that I may have to offer. Thank you.
Great. So, teachers who are on the call, you have it here. The handbook that you need to start following from tomorrow morning when you're taking your online classes. If I may come to Ruvena, you next. We have briefly glanced into the crystal ball of what it would be like once the lockdown gets over and schools go back to the new normal. What would be your handbook for the new normal? Five things.
Will you bind me down to five, or if I speak very fast, will you allow me to give you a few more?
Please take.
So I would start by thanking. I would start by thanking Ohana, because she's actually touched on a number of things that I had on my little checklist of things that I would love to see happening in classrooms, whether they are online or offline. So let's start with right at the very beginning. I would start with what I mentioned right at the start, that, you know, we would like to have more parental involvement, because your online classes are happening in the comfort, hopefully in the comfort of a child's home, right? So let's involve the parents. Now, how do you do that? I'm giving you a very concrete example of something that myself and another colleague of mine, what we like to call a gratitude jar. So if you as a teacher, speak to your students about starting this gratitude jar or a gratitude box, where you have a little glass bunny or a plastic container in which every day the child and maybe even each member of the family, on a little chit of paper, they write something that they are grateful for that particular day of the lockdown. Today I am grateful for this. And you roll it up and no one's allowed to see it, and you put it into your gratitude jar. And at the end of this lockdown, which could be 2 weeks later or we never know when, but you decide a deadline, and then on that particular day, maybe after dinner, you empty out the jar in the middle of the dining table or onto the bed, and you ask people to all of the family members to pick up those little chits, and you read your reasons to be grateful. It is an exercise in counting your blessings. What will happen is an increase in bonding within the family members. You will be contributing to the child's growth and emotional development. And with that increased bonding between child and parent, you will have created a platform where the parent can now speak to the child beyond the confines of what happened in class today, what is the homework, what is the classwork. You go beyond and you begin to speak emotionally to your child, so you're able to connect with your child. And then when you talk to your child and say, you know, I would like you to pay more concentration in class, the other day during the math class I saw that you were fidgeting with something and you were not listening to what the teacher was saying, the child may actually listen to you. And by doing so, you are making the teacher's job a little more easier. Because let's face it, whether the teacher is in an actual classroom or in an online classroom, the teacher is struggling with numbers like 30, 40, 50. You as a parent have just one or maybe two children at home. So through this exercise of gratitude and counting your blessings, you build up emotional bonds where you open the doors of communication, positive communication, wherein the parent can motivate the child to cooperate more in the classroom. I hope this is making sense to everyone out there. What I'm also looking at is teachers engaging the children. Before they do that, I would say the mantra should be know thy student, because we're still at the start of the school term. So if a teacher can invest a little bit of the teaching learning time into knowing the students better. You can do a little circle time activity where you ask each child to introduce themselves, not only with their name, but by describing themselves using the first alphabet of their name. And therefore, somebody whose name is, let's say, Susan, says that I am Sweet Susan. Or somebody whose name is Shaharish says that I am Happy Harish. So there is this little introduction that happens in the classroom, and the teacher also participates in it. And through it, you enhance teacher-student relationships before you even enter into the teaching-learning process, because we're still at the start of the school year. Moving on into other suggestions which Ohana also gave us, make it interactive. Use quizzes. Use role play where a student volunteers can be given topics that can be the starting point of discussion in the class for the first 10 minutes before the teacher comes in and takes on with the rest of the topic. So let's say a class in EVS. Recently in Calcutta, we've been reading about how clean the river is, and therefore we're seeing, after decades, we're seeing the appearance of dolphins in the River Hooghly, something unthinkable which even we had never heard of. Therefore, some child brings that fact to class, and from there you enter into an EVS class where you're talking about the reductions in the level of pollution, and then you take it into your discussion on pollution. So we are talking about making classes interactive, child-centric, enjoyable, and fun. Another interesting aspect of any class which enhances a number of things in the class is the use of humor. It enhances retention and recall. There's a lot of research available on the net which will tell you that it increases divergent thinking skills. So it encourages children to think out of the box. It creates a pleasant atmosphere, encourages group cohesion. It also lets the teacher's human side be seen, and it increases once again teacher and student bonding. Because when you are able to establish an emotional connect with your children, you will then be able to ask for their attention, grab their attention, and it will be given happily to you. It will not be something coming forced. Another thing which I liked, which Shamiji beautifully brought out, make it visual. Because research actually shows that in a 1 minute online video, you are actually covering 1.8 million written words with just a 1 minute online video. So you're improving learning styles, you're increasing the rate of retention, you're grabbing their attention, you're holding their attention, you're helping them to learn better. So using all of these, I've given you some concrete examples, I've given you some general things. We can look at helping them to structure their day, to have timetables, to have routines. You can encourage them to take up new hobbies, which they will then come back to class and discuss. And in doing so, you can tell them that there is so much more to classroom learning than just being tied down by classwork, homework, and textbooks. And hopefully, by using these little bits of a suggestion that we've given, our teachers who are listening in today would be able to engender a lot more interest in their classes, bring about better student bonding with themselves, and therefore achieve what we are talking about today, intrinsic motivation. Thank you. Over to you, Mr. Roy.
Thank you so much. Thank you, Ms. Sanyal. Thank you, Ms. Ghosh. And thank you, Mr. Rao. This has been a fantastic discussion, and I'm sure everybody who has attended will go back today with a wealth of takeaways in terms of what to do tomorrow morning as teachers, what to do as parents, on how to interact better with their children, and if they are teachers, what challenges to anticipate once the lockdown gets over. Thank you. Thank you so much. That's the end of the panel discussion, and we will now move on to the questions and answers. We've had questions given to us on the Q&A panel during the course of this webinar. We also have had a few questions submitted to us prior to this when people were registering. Abhishek, if you can have the panelists unmuted, I will direct the questions one by one. The first question says, what is the changing role of the teacher and how do we support that new role? There's a very similar question which says, what would be the best way to approach this conversation and what ideas do we need to discard or adapt in changing our understanding of what learning is? So the role of learning and the role of a teacher. If I can ask Swamiji to please take this one. Swamiji, would you be around to take this question? While we wait for him to connect back, I will take one question that is addressed directly to Mr. Bharat, sir. Sir, how to incorporate all these strategies for pre-primary children where the children are a passive receptor?
Okay. So can you hear me over there?
Yes, sir. Loud and clear.
So, okay. So first of all, let me attempt to answer this. I don't think there's ever a passive learner in a young child. The kids very often are told to shut up and sit still, but this is anathema for very young children. And very young children don't lack motivation. If you see them play at a playground, they're bubbling with enthusiasm and energy. They scream and express themselves. They ask questions. They seek. They explore. What they need is a bit of management, focus, and affection, maybe patience and firmness to put them, you know, in the right direction. But we need to build on this energy and their desire to explore. And so a lot of work that you can do online with them is to do with play, dance, singing, creation, drawing, and working with material, which is available at home, let's say, you know, paper, water, sand. A lot of lessons for them, for young children, can be singing, yoga, dancing, and taking them through directed activities. Like, for example, I believe that early chemistry is taught through cooking, where they can help their mothers. You know, recipes are sent, simple recipes, and how to mix and, you know, mix portions of various substances. How do you blend it? When do you add it to the fire? I really believe that physics can be taught through Lego, the Meccano sets, with strings, straws, and magnets, which are all available at home. And I think maths too can be made interesting. The concept of pi, for example, can be taught through experiments. Let them explore now so that when school reopen, the kids are not, you know, they haven't been put back. They actually been put forward. A lot of history can be taught through stories, documentaries. Asterix and Tintin have a lot of history in it. And geography too, through videos, Discovery Channel, taking them for nature walks if it's permissible. And English can be taught through a lot of group discussions where the children look at the teacher and they can interact with them, nursery rhymes, stories. The idea is to keep these sessions short, crisp, and exciting. Lots of images. Also, as all our panelists, the panelists said, try and get the parents involved with the task of helping them. And assignments could be more in the form of drawing, sticking, craft, experimentation. Let them feedback to the teacher. So in short, I think young children have to be taught differently. And these are some of my suggestions. Over to Ishabayu.
Thank you so much, sir. I think Swamiji is back online. Sir, if you can hear me, there's a question posed to you.
Tell me.
The question says, what is the changing role of the teacher and how do we support that new role? Another very similar question is, what ideas do we need to discard or adapt in changing our understanding of what learning is?
Okay. The 2-3 factors are over there. Can you hear me now?
Yes, sir. Clearly.
Okay. 2-3 factors are over here. Firstly, as I said, don't get panicked because of this changing scenario. First. Second thing is that whatever you are teaching in a regular class, just go on with that. Only thing is that you will be equipped with more devices which will help your teaching to be soothing for a student also. Second thing is that, as I said, go for the class with love and affection as usual. Isn't it? Not that this student, you are not able to see the student over there in front of you, all are muted and video is off. But still, they are there, they know you very well. And because of that, whatever you are delivering, that will be accepted over there, grasped over there. Rather than, I would like to say, use the maximum whiteboard as well as annotation tools, which will make it very much interesting. sometimes what happens, we have found it out, the student also starts scribbling over there. So there are certain techniques where we can stop the student from scribbling on your what you are writing over there. So these are the small things that need to be known and accordingly implemented in day-to-day our teaching. And one more thing is that you don't be hesitant about anything. As the experience will go one day or another, you will be upgrading yourself. You will be interacting with your course teachers. And from there, you will get the clue how to troubleshoot the problem. And in this way, if you go for 1 week, then you are the master of the situation for whole of your life. Secondly, extensive use of worksheet. That must be insist upon, because that will give the writing practice to the students and that writing will be improved. Secondly, whatever quizzes and other things which we will be conducting, that will give them still deeper insight. And apart from this, after the end of this class, you can share certain links through WhatsApp also. You can have a group, WhatsApp group of all the student as well as teacher teaching in a specific class. So anytime 24/7, you will be always in touch with your student, and any problem comes, student can pose the question or query over there and you can solve at any time also. So we have the restriction in the school as far as the communication is concerned, but through online or digitalization, that restriction get reduced to zero. You are always available for your student, and student feel very much cozy when they find their teacher is always by their side. Secondly, the question paper checking. Most of the time what happens now, in the school, the teacher keep on going and attending their classes, and any test or anything they take, it become difficult for them to check the question, answer sheet. But here you have the online facility to check it out and give back to the students so that they can review their answers and upgrade themselves. So in this way, the quality of teaching can be improved.
Thank you so much, sir. Thank you for that answer. I hope that very well answers both the questions that we posed to you. The next question, if I can have Vivek taking this one. Vivek is our head of institutional partnerships. Vivek, we have a question saying gadget handling has a negative feedback for the growing children. What measures should be taken to reduce the same?
That's a really, Shubhayu, I must say that's a very interesting question, because as a parent, at this point of a time when due to this coronavirus, where all the schools are locked down and all the children, the only option they have is to use digital learning, digital aid basically. So I think gadget has become part of our life, their life, children's life, and also our life. So this is a common question that most of the parents think about. I think there are two ways of looking at this particular question. One is that we can do a lot of supervision, handling this with supervision, talking to the children, making them understand that this is the way, these are the rights and these are the wrongs. And also, there's one more way we can handle this is, of course, for some children who are really naughty, what we can do is we can block websites. That option is there. We can block certain website and we can keep certain website open. Plus, the facilities like companies like Notebook, they are providing is this digital content can be also accessed on television. So once it goes to television, the entire family can see it. So the learning will actually happen for everyone in the family, right? Another way of looking at this particular thing, a question is, how about increasing the value system, basically discussing with children and making them understand. I remember when I was a kid and I used to go to school, we had a moral value chapter separately, which I don't see anymore in most of the schools, in which in our school itself, we were taught what is right and what is wrong. So inculcating good habits amongst children. So there are two ways, as I told you, looking at it. One is a lot of restriction by not trusting your child. Second is trust your child, give him that liberty and freedom to access the digital content, move through the media, move through the internet, But at the same time, having that bonding of trust wherein you trust the child and child understands the meaning of this trust. So I think this is one of the most important ways, because all of us, most of us, I should say, not all of us, most of us are parents. And I'm also a parent. My daughter, she's accessing entire digital content through internet. And there's a mutual trust between father and daughter. She has her own phone. And I know that my daughter is not going to go in any other website other than educational websites and something where she learns something. So these are the, I personally feel that all of us should, this is a very good time, because in the situation of lockdown, we don't have any other option. We're not going to work. We are with our children. So I think this is the perfect time to spend more time with them, make them understand, and also develop good values in them and a bonding of trust. I think that's most important. I support that rather than locking your things and putting a lot of restrictions. So it's a child psychology. If we start locking up things, they're more curious to open that lock. So I personally feel that we should not put any locks, rather than open those locks, let them see the net and build a mutually trust, I should say, an environment of trust in the family. And I'm sure children do understand everything, because all of us at one point of time, I'm sure we were children at one point of time. Now we are adults, but we all understand. We've gone through the same process, same age, same things. So I think that answers, and I hope that with this answer, all my audience who are listening to me would understand and also take few steps in as a parent in building a environment of trust and ensuring that the children are learning, because the ultimate purpose of education is learning. So I support that learning shouldn't be hampered at this point of time, and all of us should focus on improving, enhancing learning, and most importantly, making it fun by learning, and also children should love learning at this point of time. Thank you, Shubhayu.
Thanks, Vivek. We had a very similar question saying how to keep check on the child if both parents are working. I guess Vivek's answer takes care of that question as well. The next question is about notebook. Ochin, if you can take this one. The question asks, how is it different from other educational websites?
Okay. Ochin? Thanks, Shubhayu. So I guess, can you hear me?
Yeah, loud and clear.
So I guess, interesting question. So this also takes me back, you know, by a couple of years when we embarked on this journey of starting notebook. One thing that we were very clear from the word go was that we never ever wanted to build a Me Too brand. The objective was not to, you know, imitate somebody else's success, but the objective was to do something meaningful where we can actually add value. So initially when we started this, first 6 months, I traveled across more than 20 universities across the world, spoke to research scholars, students, professors, trying to understand that what is going to be our secret sauce, what will be that unique recipe which will make us different. I also found that answer closer back home when we went to more than 100 districts, spoke to teachers, parents. I also believe parents are active, you know, stakeholders in education, actively involved. Students, most important, trying to understand that what is the issue which we can solve? How can we actually ensure a better tomorrow? So there are a few things that we embarked on. First and most important, entire notebook pedagogy is built around the concept of augmented storytelling, which is completely new in India. Research has proved, so there was a paper by one of the research scholars in Harvard University. Research has proved that augmented storytelling as a concept, where each and every topic is narrated to the student as a story, ensures maximum retention. So the objective is to enhance the takeaway factor. So coming to the pedagogy aspect, as Shubhayu mentioned, when we worked on our pedagogy, we were very clear that we wanted a short and crisp pedagogy. We again divided our entire offering into two distinct categories. First, foundation years, classes 1 to 8, and second, board years, crossroad years, classes 9 to 12. Accordingly, if you go through our content, you'll see pedagogy is quite different. So in classes 9 to 12, we also have laid equal stress on the examination part of it. Having said that, knowledge being most important, we have always ensured conceptual clarity should be of utmost importance. Third, at Notebook, if you look at our videos, we are an after-school app, meaning to say the objective has never been to replace the teacher, but to supplement and support them. Fourth, which again is very important, if you look at our peers, you will see animation has been something which has been synonymous with EdTech brands. We very consciously, when we started this, we also had a small pilot group of students, teachers, parents. So we keep on interacting with them. Any Notebook video that we make, we first show it to them. And only once we get a thumbs up, that video is uploaded. So when we started this, we wanted to understand that how good animation is. So there are two extremes. So on one hand, we had print. On the other hand, we had completely animated content, similar to what you find in, you know, children's cartoon channels. So we're very clear that we wanted to strike a balance between the two. So in Notebook, the use of animation has been kept to bare minimum only in lower classes, where it helps in retaining a student's attention. Otherwise, apart from that, we have very consciously replaced animation with a lot of beautiful hand-drawn illustrations. We have a huge talented pool of artists who work with us from various institutions across the country. So some of them have tremendously contributed to this more than 10,000 videos that we have today. So very consciously, we have drifted away from animation. Third, if you look at all different EdTech brands, you'll see there's a clear distinction between brands who supply school content and others who are only into retail. Like meaning to say, students can access the same from their homes. We realized that these two universes are not watertight compartments. They can't be completely different, right? Because it's the same student who goes to the school and comes back and studies at home. So very consciously, what we did is Notebook videos were prepared in such a way that they can fit into the classroom regime. As Shubha, you rightly mentioned, that in a 40-minute class, we cannot expect the teacher to play a 30-minute video. That's impractical. The teacher has many better things to do. So very consciously, our videos, the average length of a Notebook video has been kept to 6 to 8 minutes. So the teacher introduces a topic, plays a video, and carries forward the discussion. The teacher can choose to end the class with a short recap video of 2 to 3 minutes or start the next class, might be after a gap of 2 days, to refresh the whole thing. Third, at Notebook, we have always believed that we wanted to involve all the stakeholders in education. So we are humbled at the kind of response that we are getting. We are one of the fastest growing EdTech brands in India. Every day, I see our student count jumping by thousands. Today, during this lockdown, the kind of response that we are getting. But what makes me most happy is the kind of response that we are also getting from Tier 2 and Tier 3 towns. From places, remote places, we see students accessing our content, sending us feedback mails, parents trying to reach out to us, teachers continuously adding value with their suggestions. So being able to engage with this whole ecosystem of parents, students, teachers, I guess that is what makes Notebook unique. Thank you. I guess, Shubhav, that answers your question.
Yes, Ajin, thank you. We really are short on time, so we could not take any more questions. Two particular questions, one regarding how to use online education for children with ADHD and how to work with children who are introverted in such a setting. We would ask the counselors that we had on the panel today to get back to you over email separately. Ajin, can I invite you back for the vote of thanks?
Right. Now, I guess it has been a great session. I really appreciate all of you taking your time out and also our distinguished panelists. But as always, your comments really added value. Swamiji, I like the way you deliberated on the whole topic. That was phenomenal. Really adds a new dimension to the whole thing. And also, our distinguished panelists, Mr. Rao, Ruhena, and Ohana. I think certain facts that came will really change the way we look at things. And I completely agree with the fact that students are not passive recipients to motivation. There's no doubt someone on it. Motivation is a two-way process. I think it has been a great session. We really look forward to having you back in our future sessions. Thank you. Stay home, stay safe, take care, and goodbye.